If we treat an encryption function as the one in GSM as something that takes a message, produces an encrypted message, and consumes a key to perform that. There are different ways in which you can make this resistant against time memory trade-offs. So three different mitigations. First, you can make the message unpredictable. Sounds obvious. Why would you encrypt something predictable? But a lot of systems do just encrypt a whole stream of data, mm-hmm. some of which is encryptable. Something is worth protecting. Right. And GSM mixes the two.
And so, all of these attacks, you know some, because of the GSM protocol, there's some messages that are very easy to guess, and you know
exactly
what they are, and can use those in this attack.
To exchange a text message, for instance, between the base station and your phone, somewhere between 20 and 40 messages are exchanged. Only one of which has the actual text message okay. contents. Another one may have some unpredictable setup information. All the rest is just management information, encrypted though. And that management information is usually...
Does it make sense as one solution to not encrypt the management information?
Clearly,
there's
yeah.
no.
And there's a standard extension.
Data in that.
There's a standard extension that suggests exactly that, but basically the whole ecosystem would have to change to accommodate for that. So currently, just the encryption is switched on at some point, and everything thereafter is encrypted, be it predictable or not. There are measures, though, to make predictable messages more randomized, to create some wiggle room for how you send a message,
okay.
and that's currently being deployed. Not in all networks, though. I've not seen one of the two American networks.
You need to know that the base station is understanding if you change the protocol like that.
The base station would have to change to go all the way of making all messages unpredictable, but even changing the base station controllers, bigger installations that control dozens of base stations, would do the job, and those are usually
okay.
software updatable because they have to accommodate for usually faster connections
mm-hmm.
all the time. Now, more secure connections I could do too hasn't been seen too much yet. We do track that on gsmmap.org. So the second way, of course, of making a system uncrackable is to decrease the key size sufficiently so that none of these trade-offs leads to practical values anymore. And that is used, for instance, in 3G and 4G networks most of the time. And then a third way of protecting against these types of attacks that assume if you predict a message, you have a direct mapping between message out and key, is to introduce an auxiliary input. It's usually called either a nonce for random number or an initialization vector.
Okay.
And GSM, in fact, does have an initialization vector. So you would think that creating that it breaks the correlation between key and message, because now you'd have to compute your table separately for every nonce, and they are...
This is sort of like adding salt to passwords to prevent
exactly.
dictionary attacks.
This is the exact same system as adding salt. So this has been included in GSM. However, the nonce is only effective if the attacker has to go for the key to break the system. There are different encryption functions that are attackable with time memory trade-offs in different ways, in particular for block ciphers. This protection measure works out of the box because a block cipher consumes the key, crunches it in complex ways, and outputs the message. Unlike so, stream ciphers, they take the key, do one small computation, do the same computation again, do the same computation again, in the case of GSM 100 times, and then output the message. So it becomes a function that's consistent of very many smaller functions, and the nonce is of course only inputted at the very beginning. So to make this now resistant against time memory trade-off, the intermediate states, those results of the first round, second round, and so forth to the hundreds rounds, have to be a non-attackable time memory trade-off. And that sometimes is achieved by a large internal state of the function. For instance, the GPRS functions, or edge functions, 2.5G networks, they also consume a 64-bit key, but they have an internal state of at least 96 bits. So that is a protection, because now the attacker has to go for the key after all. However, if you use a small internal state, then the attacker can go to attack that internal state, and GSM falls exactly in this category, and then the countermeasure doesn't work anymore.
So the internal state is still 64 bits.
Exactly.
Combining the key and the nonce.
Yeah, message in, the key, and the message out, as well as the internal state. Everything is 64 bits in GSM. And of course, adding an internal state, a larger internal state, doesn't come at a great cost. It takes a few more flip-flops in a hardware implementation, or slightly larger words in a software implementation.
So this didn't prevent the attack that you described, but the attack you showed us was actually better than this, to do that. And lookups would have taken hours. You were able to show it working in a matter of seconds or minutes.
To explain why GSM is more vulnerable, we have to go a little bit into this discussion we started earlier on the 100 little function instead of one big function, what makes this a stream cipher. So this stream cipher consumes in the beginning both a key and the IV, as we've seen, but then does a computation 100 times to produce an internal state that is then mapped onto the output. That then XORed with the message is basically the output message. Interesting is this part though, because each of these links is such a small computation that you can easily reverse it. It is non-linear, meaning you cannot really reverse it with 100% certainty, but it's such a small computation that you can just kind of brute force the input space.
Okay.
Right? So little.
But the input space is small.
Just a few bits change in each of these steps. Okay. So you can just go through all the possibilities of the input space and see which ones map back to your output, right? Okay. Now you may end up with several. So it's not always that only one of the inputs would have produced. That's exactly the nonlinear property, right? However, this may look as a complication at first, but does in fact help the hacker, because each of these also generates a key for some given IV that you assume. Well, at least some may be dead ends. Right? But at least in a lot of cases, you can track one point that you store in your table back to different keys.
I see. Okay, so different starting key IV pairs lead to the same output.
Exactly. And on average, for each value that you store in the table, you have 13 keys that you find every time. Only one of them will be the correct one. Sometimes even all 13 are wrong.
Nice.
But if you do find a key, it will just be one of them. However, storing this point in the table is equivalent to storing 13 points in the table for a better function.
Is the equivalent of doing 13 lookups?
No, the lookup actually is the same effort, but the storage is decreased. So this is basically an inherent encryption function for rainbow tables that this system comes with.
Okay.
So we're 13 times more efficient with this encryption function than with a generic 64-bit encryption function.
Okay.
And so 13 times in such a trade-off with all the different tweaks is the difference between hours and seconds. It's not a linear
difference. You're shrinking the table by a factor of 10. which is making all the lookups less expensive.
Exactly. Basically, we're having 13 times more storage, and in the trade-off, storage is quadratic. So we're more efficient as an approximation by this factor, and that's the difference between seconds and hours. And that's why SMS can be snooped in seconds.